This morning, I would like to talk to you again about purpose. That might be a shock to you, but I'm going to talk to you about purpose. And the letter of the acronym that I'm going to use today is R, Realized in Community. So what I'm going to talk to you about, I want you to just stay focused on the fact that it is realized in community. I'm going to talk to you today about your story. How many of you have a story? Everybody's hand should go up. Everybody has a story. It's not fiction. Well, some of you might add a little fiction in there just for fun. But our story is our story, and our story is our journey, and our story is not only lived out, but it is realized in community. Our story should be a benefit to ourselves and to others. Now, when we talk about community, of course, we're talking about a faith community. So we're talking about realized in our faith community. But how many of you know that you have a community at work? Your workplace is, in fact, a type of community. Your neighborhood is, in fact, a type of community. If you're in school, your school setting is a type of community. And so your story has to be lived out and realized in community, in all of the communities in which we find ourselves involved. Now, our story is different than our testimony. I want you to think about that for a minute. How many of you have heard a testimony and had a split response? Your response is, praise God, that's great that God did that for you. Wonder how come God didn't do something like that for me? So sometimes, although our testimonies are building, our testimonies are used to build each other up, sometimes a testimony has kind of the opposite effect, because you share the victory, you share the joy, you share the miracle, you don't always share the struggle. You just say, God did it. Amen. Hallelujah. I'm healed. But you don't talk about the nights that you laid crying in your bed waiting for God to move. You don't talk about the sorrow that you felt when you watched others receive a miracle and you were left wanting still. So our stories are so different from our testimonies because our stories embrace our journey, which travels the person through our difficulties, through victories, on to more difficulties, on to more victories, on to how we handle. Do you see what I'm saying? So, for example, if I've struggled with something, my story will include that. My testimony may not. To others, when we live in community, our story is our witness. It is how we live Jesus out loud. So, for example, if you're in community, not necessarily your faith community, but let's say your work or your school community or your physical community where your house is and where you live, and something negative or something bad happens, and you respond a certain way that might be different than how other people in that setting might think you would respond, what are they going to ask you? Why'd you respond that way? Or why aren't you falling apart? Or why aren't you doing this? Or why aren't you doing that? Then we begin to tell them our story. Well, I'm not falling apart because I have this experience or this deep-seated experience in Christ that has led me through multiple difficulties in the past, so I know I'll make it through this. Or I wouldn't be able to respond like this except for the depth of Jesus in my life. I wouldn't be able to. So our story becomes our testimony in fact. And our testimonies that we sometimes share, they're snippets, but our story is lived out in real life because real things happen on a daily basis. I just talked to a woman, she's elderly. She didn't tell me how old she was, but I'm guessing she's got to be in late 70s, maybe early 80s, but for sure late 70s, and she still works, which I think is an amazing thing. And she says, I work because I love what I do. I don't work for the money because, believe me, it's not a lot, but I work because of what I do. And she tells a story about a neighbor who parked a little close to her driveway where he shouldn't have, and she came out and hit him. And she talked about him coming out and using some very colorful terms to describe what he thought of a woman of her age still driving a car. And she said, you know, I was so angry, I just couldn't forgive him. She said he came back, he apologized, and I just couldn't forgive him. And I looked at her and I said, wow, how's it feel to drag that guy around all this time? And she looked at me kind of out of the corner of her eye. She said, what are you talking about? And I said, well, you know, forgiveness really isn't for them. I said, forgiveness is for us. And she said, ah, that's a perspective I hadn't thought of. Now, I got to tell her my story about forgiving people and of being forgiven. And it was living Jesus out loud to her in a real life situation. We should tell our stories to ourselves. Because when we tell our stories to ourselves, it reminds us of where we've come from. And it reminds us that we're going somewhere. Jesus did not bring us this far to leave us. We are on a journey. We are on a road, we are on a pathway, we are on a life process that will end up with us someday meeting him face to face on that wonderful day when we graduate from this life to eternity. And along the way, we're going to experience things that will make up our story, and we'll have to remind ourselves. Now, do I think you should live in the past and dwell on where you've come from? No, I don't think so. But I think you always have to have in the back of your mind, this is where Jesus brought me from, and this is where he's taking me to. Now, I don't know anybody who does this better than the Jewish people. Because once a year, they tell their story. Once a year at Passover, which starts next Monday night on April 10th, is the first night of Passover. They tell the story of their slavery and their deliverance and their entrance into the promised land. And they tell it so they will remember the bondage from which they came. Now, if you tell your story about your past like some glorifying thing of all the bad things you used to do, and you make that the point, that's the wrong way to tell your story. It should be from the perspective of the bondage that God brought you through. And the bondage he prevented you from returning to. Because backsliding or turning away is simply returning to the bondage from which we were once delivered. And I want to tell you, the Egyptians, what did they say? Just send us back to Egypt. Because the demons I know are better than the demons I don't know, right? The life I know is sometimes more comfortable than the life of freedom that I haven't yet known. But I want to tell you, God would not let them go back into their bondage. That's why he opened the Red Sea and why he closed it back over Pharaoh's army. Because they couldn't go back. And I want you to know that in the spiritual realm, if you go back, you are in fact asking God to open up and expose all of your enemies which he has destroyed. You are asking him to open up that Red Sea and bring back to life all the enemies which he very proficiently destroyed so that you could not be taken back into slavery. And by telling our story, we remind ourselves from whence we've come and that we don't want to go back there. Now, Psalms 136, Psalms 135, Psalm 78, those are all psalms that tell the story. So if we look at, let's look at Psalm 78. Only because Pastor Art and I argued about whether this was the Passover psalm or not. I think he said 73. He said 78. I'm pretty sure he said 73. It really is 78. But this isn't the one they use in the Passover. Just so you're clear. So here it says, he goes back and he recounts all of Israel's past. He talks about all of these things, splitting open the rocks in the wilderness, bringing the water out of the rocks. In the beginning, he talks about not hiding the truths from our children and telling the next generation. He commanded the ancestors to teach them to their children so the next generation might know. Each generation should set its hope anew on God, for they will not be like their ancestors, stubborn, rebellious, unfaithful, refusing to give their hearts to God. That's a great psalm of recounting. And then if you go to Psalms 135, starting in verse 8, he talks about destroying the firstborn of each Egyptian home, performing miraculous signs and wonders in Egypt, struck down great nations, gave their land, the kings that he struck down, he gave their land as inheritance and a special people, special possession to his people. He talks about the idols are merely silver and gold, and they don't have eyes, and who can trust in them? And then he talks about praise the Lord, et cetera, et cetera. And then the psalm we're going to really focus on is 136, which you can turn there. And this is the psalm that is in part, it's not the exact psalm that's used in the Seder, but it's kind of in a similar meter. It's a similar meter as the words of that are spoken in the Passover. And it says, give thanks to the Lord for he is good. And then after everything, there's a response. It says, his faithful love endures forever, or his mercy. Some translations say his mercy endures forever. So give thanks to the Lord. Give thanks to the God of gods. His faithful love endures forever. Give thanks to the Lord of hosts. His faithful love endures forever. Give thanks to him who alone does mighty miracles. His faithful love endures forever. Give thanks to him who made the heavens so skillfully. Give thanks to him who placed the earth among the waters. Give thanks to him who made the heavenly lights, the sun to rule by day, the moon and the stars to rule by night. Give thanks to him who killed the firstborn of Egypt. He brought Israel out of Egypt. He acted with a strong hand and a powerful arm. Give thanks to him who parted the Red Sea. He led Israel safely through, but he hurled Pharaoh and his army into the Red Sea. Give thanks to him who led his people through the wilderness. Give thanks to him who struck down mighty kings. He killed powerful kings, Sihon, king of the Amorites, Og, the king of Bashan. God gave the land of these kings as an inheritance, a special possession to his servant Israel. Now listen to this part. He remembered us in our weaknesses. He saved us from our enemies. He gives food to every living thing. Give thanks to the God of heaven. His faithful love endures forever. Now, when you look at that, sometimes we don't want to tell our children our story because we don't want them to know what we were into before we were into Jesus. We kind of think they're never going to find out. Well, they probably will. And it's better that they hear it from you than they hear it from Uncle Marvin, you know, or Aunt Sophia, who just has to tell. I remember a deep family secret that had been kept from me for probably 20 years. And one day Art and I were visiting my Aunt Helen, and she just laid the whole story out before us. And I was like, I called my mom. My mom said, don't you tell anyone that you know that. She was never supposed to say that. But, you know, now I know, and I'm guessing Aunt Helen shared her wisdom with multiplicity of my cousins. So probably everybody knows, but we all act like we don't know, so we just don't deal with it. But what happens when we tell where we've come from is we help the next generation not make the same mistakes that we made. Now, there's a tension in every parent's heart to keep your children from making the same mistakes that you made. And so this tension is that you want to protect them from all the mistakes that you made, and you don't want them to make those mistakes. But the reality is that every generation has to make some mistakes on their own, because that's how we learn. What does God say how we learn obedience? Through the things that we have suffered. So if you prevent your child, if you put your child in some kind of a bubble where they are always wonderful, they are always a winner, they are always amazing, they are always a prince or a princess, they are just all that plus five bags of chips, all different flavors. You actually set your child up not to learn obedience. Because if you don't allow your child to make some mistakes on their own, they will forever think of themselves as perfect, as wonderful, as beautiful, as a princess, as whatever, and in the back of their mind, they will know that's not true, and they will go through enormous pain and enormous suffering trying to rectify those two things in their own hearts. So you have to give your child a parameter in which to make mistakes when they're young enough for your corrective hand to be there to help them through. If you wait to let your child make mistakes until they're out on their own, you've missed a huge, huge, huge important part of parenting. Children have to be allowed to make mistakes. So when we make mistakes, we have to know where the mistakes are guiding us. Do you see what I'm saying? They have to know that that's part of the process. A mistake is not a failure. A mistake is an opportunity to learn obedience. A mistake has to be seen as a learning tool, not a failure or a deficiency. If we teach our children that they are deficient because they have made mistakes, we will miss God's intention for mistakes. If we don't talk to our children about the mistakes that we've made and the obedience we've learned through those mistakes, we again will rob them of foundational stones that they need for their own life. In the Passover, it's an elaborate, and when I say elaborate, I mean it is elaborate. It is an elaborate process of telling your story. First of all, there's formal dinnerware that is used. During Passover, if you're a kosher, if you're an Orthodox Jew and you're kosher, even if you're not so religious, you use completely separate pans to prepare your food. You use kosher pans, and you it's just, you know, I don't want to go into all the details between kosher and non-kosher and what pans are used for what, but, you know, you got milk pans and meat pans and, you know, it's just everything. And then you have to sell all the yeast that's in your home. You know, it's an elaborate process. So next Sunday, all the Jews who live around, if you live around Jews, they will come and they'll want to sell you their bread. And you just give them, it's not the price that matters, it's that they have to get rid of it. So they sell off their flour, they sell off their bread, they sell off anything that has yeast in it and clear their home of sin. Okay, because the yeast represents sin. So they get rid of all sin. And then when it's time for the meal, you begin by lighting candles. It's a holy day. It's a holy celebration. You light candles and you sing or say this saying. It is Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu Melech haolam asher kitzvesenu mitzvivasho vitzvanu latki nerhel Pesach. And that just means, blessed are you, Lord our God, King of the universe, who has sanctified us with his commandments and commanded us that we kindle the holiday lights according to Pesach, or to Passover. So there's multiple prayers. They're said in English, they're said in Jewish, depending on what, or Hebrew, whether the family reads that or not. And then you start the service. And the service is really long. It takes hours to get through a Passover service. There's ritual hand washing. There's the breaking of the middle matzah, which we'll talk about in just a second. There's four questions that are asked. Why is this night different? On all other nights, we eat bread. You know, on all other nights, we eat herbs. You know, why on this night do we eat only herbs and vegetables? You know, the children ask the questions. So the children are asking, why are we doing this? These are logical things. But in the Jewish tradition, it's impaneled in the Passover celebration so that the children learn to ask questions. They're allowed to ask questions. They have, in some traditions, there's wise questions, wicked questions, simple questions, and then a simple question from a child who does not know how to ask. They cover all your kids. They cover the smart kid, the kid who's not quite sure he wants to follow in your path religiously. They follow the kid who's just doesn't quite have it all together, and they handle the kid who just doesn't know how to ask a question. And all the questions are answered. The wise child asks, what are the laws that God commands us? The wicked child asks, what does this Passover service mean to you? See the value of that question? The simple child asks, what is this Seder service? And the child who simply can't ask is prompted by the father with a partial answer to his beginning question. Now, how cool is that? That the father helps the child ask the question. Then they go through and they tell the story. They talk about each plague. They talk about they do something called the Dayenu, and it says this: if God would have taken us out of Egypt and not executed judgment upon them, it would have been enough for us. And then they say, if he would have executed judgment upon them and not upon their idols, it would have been enough for us, because they've just rehearsed that each of the 10 plagues contended with an Egyptian idol, a major Egyptian idol. Then they say, if he would have judged their idols and not killed their firstborn, it would have been enough for us. If he would have killed their firstborn and not given us their wealth, it would have been enough for us. If he would have given us their wealth and not split the sea for us, it would have been enough for us. If he would have split the sea for us and not let us through it on dry land, it would have been enough for us. If he would have let us through on dry land and not drowned our enemies in it, it would have been enough for us. If he would have drowned our enemies in it and not provided for our needs in the desert for 40 years, it would have been enough for us. Now, I want to tell you the value of your story in real life situations. Not today, because of time, but go back and read Exodus and see if the Israelites at each one of those turns said, Lord, it is enough for us. They did not. What did they say the minute they got through the Red Sea? I just told you. Oh, let us go back to Egypt. At least we had meat over there. You know, oh, we were in bondage. We were working like 20 out of 24 hours a day, but at least we had meat. Then it was at least we had water, you know, at least, you know, and then the manna wasn't good enough, and then the water wasn't good enough, and then it was too long. But as you tell the story in retrospect, you see the goodness of the Lord, and that's when it would have been enough starts to come out. So it builds faith in the next generation. You go on. Now listen, you haven't even eaten yet. Remember I said this was a Seder meal. We're on page 12 and we haven't even eaten yet and we're only on the second cup of wine. So we're all suffering right now. So they bless the matzah. They've already broken it. They've already hidden it. They've already done all those things and they've already eaten the bitter herbs and it comes time now for the meal and they eat the meal. And then after the meal, they find the afikoman, they eat it, and then they go through Psalms 135, then they sing songs, and then they close the Seder with this. We have finished the Passover Seder according to its precepts and customs. Next year in Jerusalem, may we eat the Passover in peace. So there's hope for what God is going to do. And in some, they often talk about bringing in the Messianic era at the end of the Passover, because that's when they realize that there'll be peace. Now, when we talk about bringing in the Messianic era at the end of a Passover, we know that we can walk in peace now, no matter what's going on in our real life story. So here's my challenge to you as I close. And we are going to take communion. But as I close, I'm going to challenge you to think about this week a way that sometime next week, between Palm Sunday and Easter, during Passover, I'd like you to think of a way to write your own story for your family. I'd like you to think about having a meal together, which sometimes is hard. It's a hard thing to do, to sit down at the dinner table all together and take 2 or 3 hours and tell your story. But I want to tell you that Passover is actually a new year. There's 2 new years in the Jewish calendar. One is Rosh Hashanah Yom Kippur. That's a new year season. It's a beginning. And then and Passover is another new year. I think God knew that we needed 2 beginnings rather than 1 every year. You know, and I'm really grateful for 2 times to begin anew. But this is a beginning. And if you wrote your story, and if once a year you sat down as a family and you read your story, and you added the things that had happened over the last year, and you told your children the story of your coming to Christ, the story of your learning and growing in Christ, the story of lessons learned and some mistakes made, age appropriately, of course. of course. If you shared that and you took a whole night to talk about the goodness of God to your family, what would happen? What would the next generation be like? Because today we're busy, and what do we give our kids?
Pizza.
Pizza? Well, that's good, Cynthia. Not on Passover. Well, maybe. It's only cheese. I don't know. I have to think about that. No. You can't eat pizza. It's got yeast in the crust. We would give our children an inheritance. We would give our children a heritage. We would give our children a foundation when today we give them an iPad with the Bible on video. Here, learn about Jesus. I'm busy. Take your iPad, go to your room. Oh, and by the way, let's watch a Christian thing. And we think that's awesome that we're not letting them watch non-Christian things. We shouldn't be letting them watch at all, because they should learn Jesus at the feet of their parents. They should learn Jesus by how you navigate conflict. They should learn Jesus by how you live life. They should learn Jesus by watching you and listening to you and hearing your story. Sometimes we don't share struggles with our children, and I get it. There's got to be an appropriateness, because you can't put an adult burden on a child. That's not what I'm talking about. But sharing things that are difficult for you and how God brought you through, sharing things that were against you and God delivered you, lets your children know that the struggles that they're feeling, that they may not be articulating to you, are okay. And that if God is there for you, God will be there for them. And your openness should breed their openness. And what parent doesn't want their child to be open with them? What parent doesn't want to hear their child's heart? If you're a parent, you want to hear your child's heart. You want your child to talk to you, not a teacher, not a friend, not somebody who's going to guide them away from the precepts and the principles that you hold dear as a Christ follower. I will fight. I'm not a fighter, but I will fight someone who tries to draw one of my children away from a Christian way of life. I will fight hard. The first element that I'm going to ask you to take is a piece of parsley, and I'm going to ask you to dip it in salt water, which is in a little bowl in the middle. Because part of our story includes tears. We have to understand that coming to Christ is not an elimination of all sorrow on this side of heaven. In fact, sometimes coming to Christ means walking away from people or things, and it causes us great sorrow to walk away from things that we know we have to turn our backs on to follow Christ. It is not easy, it is painful, and don't let anybody minimize the anxiety or the decision making that you have to do to choose Christ. So we're going to come and we're going to take the herb. You guys can start to come. We're going to come and we're going to take the herb, dip it in salt water, and you can just eat it. As you just dip it, eat it, and go back to your seat. And as you do that, I want you to think about some of the things that God has brought you through that were very sorrowful at the time, but you've now found peace and joy in. We don't get the best advantage from the lessons or the victory over. And now as we begin to take the bread, I want you to know that, first of all, Passover is not the Jewish Easter. I just want you to know that. They coincide sometimes in the calendar, but Passover has absolutely nothing to do with Easter. It is a retelling of the deliverance from slavery. So, of course, as believers, we correlate that to our own deliverance from sin and our own entry into relationship with Christ. So there is a correlation on the Christian side to Passover, but Passover is not the Jewish Easter. Please understand, Easter celebrates the risen Christ whom they do not think has yet come. So there are two separate things. However, it holds great symbolism for those of us who know Christ, because the bread that Jesus took and ate was the piece in the Passover meal, in the Seder meal, called the Afikomen. And the Afikomen was not eaten if you were in Jerusalem because you ate the Passover lamb. But if you were not in Jerusalem, you took a piece of matzah, you blessed it, you broke it, you hid it, the children found it, and you redeemed it with a price, and you ate it after the meal in place of your Passover lamb. So since Jesus was eating the Passover in Jerusalem, the Afikomen would have just been a symbol, and it would have just been disposed of at the end of the meal, or eaten as a dessert, or whatever. People do different things with it. But Jesus took it, and every man at that table knew that it represented the Passover lamb, the lamb that was sacrificed, whose blood was put on the doorposts so the death angel would pass over. And he broke it, and he said, "This is my body broken for you. Take and eat in remembrance of me." So every time we take communion, we take the bread, we do it to remember Jesus' story. Because he is the one. He is the Passover lamb. He is the one whose blood allows the death angel to pass over our lives and let us live eternally forever. And so come and take the bread. During the Passover Seder, there are four cups of wine that are partaken of or that are consumed during the Passover Seder. First two are not important for communion. The third is the one that's most significant for the communion, and it is the cup of redemption. And it is taken after the meal and after the Afikomen. And it is the cup of redemption. And when Jesus picked up that cup, which was very common, everyone knew he was going to pick up the cup. Everybody knew it was the cup of redemption. Everyone knew they were going to drink it. Jesus lifted it up and he said, "This is my blood shed for you." And every man at the table, either in that moment or shortly after, understood the necessity of Christ's blood being shed for our redemption. Now the last cup is the cup of, a cup of completion. It's the cup of completion. And when you hold that cup, it's when you say, "Next year in Jerusalem, may we next year eat the Passover in peace." So redemption, the Afikomen and the cup of redemption come almost immediately before the cup of completion. And so when you take the juice, understand that this is the cup of redemption. You have celebrated all night long, and now you come to the place where Jesus says, "This is my blood shed for you, that you might live with me forever. Come and take the cup." Father, I thank you today that we have learned a little bit about your story. your story of how you chose to send your son, and how you chose throughout the history of man to give us hints of his great sacrifice. Father, how hidden in the Passover story is the great faithfulness of God, is the great sacrifice of Jesus, and is the great guidance of the Holy Spirit. Father, I thank you that as we listen to and rehearse the story of Passover, the story of the wilderness, the story of the victories over kings and the inheritance of the land, that it is in fact a type and shadow of our own journey. As we come out of bondage into a relationship with Jesus, and we cross over a chasm where our enemies are destroyed, and then we live and love and learn life in the wilderness, learning to trust you, learning to count on you, learning to depend upon you, learning to allow you to lead us until that one precious and glorious day when we cross yet another river and we go from this life to the next, where our story does not end, but it continues in a brand new chapter, joined with the stories of multitudes of others. So, Father, this morning I thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. So now you know a little bit about Passover, and I've challenged you to write your story. I'm going to leave this up here. This is the Federation, or the Jewish Federations. If you want to download it, if you want to actually do a Passover, Pastor Art and I have written a Haggadah, which is the order of service for Seder. Or if you want to know more, just call us and we'll ask us. But the meal's not important. What you do, this part isn't important. What's important is that you take a deliberate, intentional opportunity to plan a festive meal with your family, and you verbally rehearse and tell and write down your story so that one day your great-great-grandchildren will know that in 2017 you began a story that is continuing through their lives even then. Amen? Amen. Amen.